Good morning, Your Honor.
My name is Jim Lobsens. I did recently, about 3 weeks ago, I was retained by Mr. Seleznev's other lawyers to represent him at oral argument here, and I represent Mr. Seleznev.
Thanks, Mr. Lobsens. It's nice to see you again.
Nice to see you. I will hope to reserve 5 minutes.
Okay.
I plan to talk about two of the issues, not all of them, principally to talk about the sentencing issue at first, and then also to talk about the motion to dismiss and the way in which Mr. Seleznev was apprehended and brought to the United States. As to the sentencing issue, it's my position that there was both a procedural error and the sentence is also substantively unreasonable. The two are very intertwined. It's hard to tease them apart. But the procedural error is really failure to consider and failure to explain the very lengthy sentence imposed on Mr. Seleznev. Mr. Seleznev was 32 years old when he stood before the court, and he received a sentence which is almost equal, you know, to his life, 27 years. He had no prior criminal convictions. As of course the court knows, under 3553, the substantive reasonableness of the sentence is to be reviewed under the standard to see whether the length of the sentence was necessary to accomplish all the purposes listed in subsection 2 of that statute. Was it really necessary to get a 27-year sentence to protect the public from Mr. Seleznev and future crimes or any of the other purposes spelled out in 3553, like deterrence or respect for law? I noticed only yesterday that Mr. Seleznev's attorneys had not cited the en banc decision in Rassam, and so I wanted to get at least file something saying that I am in part relying upon it and bringing it to your attention. There was a pretty important thing said, a couple of important things said in that decision, one of which is that while the standard of review is deferential, it's not anything goes. And in this case, Mr. Seleznev has received a sentence which is longer than you can get if you have no prior criminal convictions for first-degree premeditated murder in state court in Washington. And that, I hope, seems to you, I hope that makes you raise an eyebrow. In Rassam, this court said on page 1091, although recidivism ordinarily decreases with age, and the court went on to say, not for terrorists and also not for sex offenders. Mr. Seleznev is not a terrorist. In fact, he's a victim of terrorism, not a terrorist, which I will get to when I talk about his medical condition. A terrorist, as I read the Rassam decision, it recognizes that terrorists are motivated by ideological and often in this day, religious concerns. Their motives for committing crimes can be go to the core of who they are, especially when it's religious. And they may even want to be a martyr. The fact that they may get caught and sent to prison or die is not the kind of thing which deters them, because in this case, in Mr. Rassam's case and others, it's a deeply held religious conviction that what they're doing is morally right. That doesn't go for people, ordinarily doesn't go for people who steal money and make money by illegal means. The district court said, and I'm not going to quarrel with it at all, that Mr. Seleznev's motives were economic gain and greed and to make a living. But my point is that ordinarily that kind of crime is not repeated if you are hammered with a fairly lengthy sentence. It's the kind of thing that burns out over time, too. Everybody likes money, but it's not reasonable to say Mr. Seleznev, after 27 years in prison, or he has to be there in 27 years, because if he gets out any earlier than that, he'll go right back to doing this. People don't like being in prison. And it is incumbent to satisfy the statute for the government to come up with some justification for why the district court could say, well, 3 years or 5 years or 7 years or 10 years is not enough to make sure that this 32-year-old man won't go out and do this kind of thing again.
Counsel, could I interject a question?
Yes.
What was the guidelines range here?
Life. Life. But because it's treated at, sort of maxed out at level 43, but it's life.
Okay, so if the maximum was life, and the court gave 27 years.
Yes.
And you think it's not substantively reasonable?
I do not.
What? It's not, right?
But I do not.
What would have been substantively reasonable? What's the most you think the district court should have sentenced him to?
I'm trying to think. If I had been the district court judge, what is the most that I could say I can justify this? 15 years? I don't know. He's 32 years old, and I haven't yet addressed the fact that he doesn't have all of his brain because half his skull was blown off and because he's got a serious traumatic brain injury and a couple of other things. But to go back a minute to your reference to the guidelines, it is the law of this circuit that and the law of the United States, I think, that there's no presumption that the guideline range is correct. And it says at the end of the PSR, there's an acknowledgement there, the last sentence in the PSR is that the author says the guidelines here clearly overstate the seriousness of this and the type of sentence the person ought to get. In this case, one of the things that his attorneys in the district court said was he had a terrible childhood. I don't think anybody disputes that. He was abandoned by his father, who moved from Vladivostok to Moscow when he was 2 years old. He had no relationship with his father. He had a mother who was an alcoholic. He had a mother who was so alcoholic that he discovered her dead from alcohol poisoning in the bathtub when he was 17 years old. He had nobody to raise him, and he had no particular avenue of how he was going to make a living and a career, and he went into crime. And that was argued as one of the things, one of the characteristics of the defendant to the district court, that you ought to take that into consideration. And the district court judge said, lots of other people grow up in poverty and they don't commit crime. And I submit that's an abuse of discretion. I mean, that's essentially rewriting the statute. That's essentially saying, I don't care that Congress in this statute said, look at the characteristics of the defendant. Lots of people have terrible childhoods, and I just don't consider that because lots of those people don't go on and commit crimes. That kind of a per se rule would lead you to say that if a child was starving and sexually and physically assaulted 3 nights a week for 15 years, that you just wouldn't consider that, because lots of people that happens to and they grow up and they don't become major criminals. That isn't logical. Small point, but I wanted to point out about the statutory purpose about respect for the law. I think it's dangerous to assume anything about the culture, the cultural values attached to respect for law that a person who grows up in Russia is going to have. I don't think it's a big leap for me to say to you that there's not a lot of respect for law in the Russian Federation or in the Soviet Union. The head of the Russian Federation is, I would say, a thug who murders his opponents. People get ahead there by corruption, by bribing people. So to say, oh, I'm going to treat you, this is necessary, 27 years to show you how to respect the law, is to blink at a characteristic of the defendant, which is important, which is that he grew up in a corrupt country which doesn't respect law and which thinks it's normal to bribe people to get ahead. I want to talk about deterrence as a purpose of the statute. Most criminals really don't think about deterrence at all. They just think they'll never get caught and it doesn't dawn on them. Criminals who do this kind of thing, I think, do think about deterrence, and the evidence in the record here, I mean, they do think about getting caught. And the evidence in the record here is that the moment he was arrested, he said, but there's no extradition treaty, is there, between the Maldives and the United States. So obviously he did think about the fact that he's going to go on vacations and travel places where there's no extradition treaty. But when you're saying, what do I have to give this man as a sentence now? Well, when he gets out, he now knows that the fact that there isn't an extradition treaty is no guarantee that he's not going to get apprehended and sent to the United States. He knows that now. So I think that's something to take into account, that you don't need to lock him up for 27 years. The most important procedural error about failure to explain committed by the district court is just simply not responding to the arguments about his medical condition. There were undisputed facts about how he got this brain injury. He was in Morocco and he had the bad fortune to go to some cafe and sit there that a suicide bomber also selected to blow himself up in. 20 people were killed, but Mr. Seleznev was not killed. He was almost killed, but he wasn't killed. And part of his skull came off. He survived. He miraculously survived. He was evacuated. He was flown to Russia. He had a year or more in Russian hospitals that he lived. All those medical records are in the record of this case, and those medical records are also in the excerpts of record. No one contests the fact that he has a chronic seizure disorder. No one contests the fact that he has a third of his top of his skull is now an artificial titanium top. No one contests the fact that he had to learn to talk and walk again because he lost the ability to do that. And no one has replied when both his attorney at the sentencing hearing said, the doctors say he can expect progressive deterioration in his mental condition. It's going to get worse as he gets older. And no one contested the fact that he and Mr. Seleznev both said, the doctors don't think I'm going to live to be in my 50s. So effectively, this is a life sentence for him. And if he ever should serve this long and get out, what reason is there to think that he's going to go right back to doing this when he doesn't have as much of a brain as a normal person does, because he lost part of it to this horrible accident? And the district court didn't respond to anything said about his medical condition, just never mentioned it. I think I would argue to you that's similar to the failure to explain.
I thought he did note his near
the district court judge
death experience.
The district court judge did not talk about his medical condition. He may have talked about the fact that I know you were in an accident, but he never talked about...
Well, he characterized it that he was, following the incident, that he had to struggle for his life due to what happened to him.
You must be right. If you're telling me that, Your Honor, there must be two or three words saying that he said that, but he didn't talk about...
Well, I mean,
he's going to die
that,
in jail.
Doesn't that suggest that he... You know, the district court judge was fully aware of it and knew about it. So what was he supposed to do?
He's supposed to explain why that, somehow, notwithstanding that, he's rejecting the defense argument that I need to lock you up for 27 years, because otherwise either you'll go back to this, or I won't protect the public, or there won't be respect for law, or one of these other things, and he doesn't explain it.
Well, suppose he says, you know, I'm aware of... Well, we can assume that he read the briefs.
Yes.
And the PSR.
Yes.
Right?
But it's like Rassam, isn't it? We can assume that Judge Kunauer read everything in Rassam, too. But Judge Kunauer did not explain why a man who repudiated his cooperation agreement, recanted his testimony, thereby sacrificing two prosecutions, why he would give him the same amount of leniency that he had given him in an earlier sentencing, when the man had done all that. And this court said that failure to explain was a procedural error, and that failure to explain carries over into the substantive error. If you can't give an explanation as to why you're doing this, then the court concluded this is an abuse of discretion.
So if the judge had said, so what you want the record to reflect is that, yes, I'm aware of your condition. The record documents what happened. Recovery was serious, a near-life-death experience, but nonetheless, I don't think that provides any basis for me to reduce the sentence.
I don't think that would be enough, Your Honor.
What's he supposed to do?
He's supposed to say why he doesn't think that would be enough. I don't think it's enough because I think you'll go back to doing this and you'll just keep stealing from banks and people even when you get out, if you live that long. I mean, he'd even answer... He's not expected to live that long, Your Honor. He didn't even answer that. Nobody answered that. I don't have a lot of time left, and I do want to touch upon the motion to dismiss and the way he was brought before the court. And I'm going to zero in on what I think is the key to my argument. It's a finding of fact made by the district court, which has no support in the record and is actually contradicted by the record. And that finding of fact is, let me see if I can find you exactly. It's in the excerpts of record, page 46. Maldivian authorities appear to have elected to accept a red notice as an alternative to a warrant. And to put that in context, the evidence is really all undisputed. These Secret Service agents, through the State Department, contacted some Maldivian authorities. They said, we want your help. Will you give us some help? They said, we'll assist you. They said, our plan is, you know, you arrest them and then you turn them over to us. They got some word back from a police commissioner, yeah, we'll arrest them and we'll turn them over to you. The Maldivians asked for documents. It's undisputed. They gave them the documents they requested. And the Secret Service agents were arriving on July 3 and 4. They're having meetings with the Maldivians, and the arrest is made on the 5th. And on the afternoon of July 4, the day before the arrest, suddenly we know from undisputed emails that involve the State Department official, suddenly the Maldivians say, we are pursuing an arrest warrant. We need an arrest warrant from a Maldivian judge. That's Exhibit 4. Says, we are waiting for that court warrant. That comes at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on July 4th. And in Exhibit 5, they are told a little bit later, I think, we expect the warrant will be done by 9. It doesn't have an a.m. or a p.m. after it, but as near as I can tell, that means 9 tomorrow morning. Then at 1:20 a.m. on the morning of July 5th, there's another exhibit that says, or there's evidence that the State Department hears the Maldivians want a red notice issued from Interpol. And it's undisputed that that red notice was issued at 7 a.m. in the morning. The issuance of that red notice creates a need for speed, at least in the minds of the agents, who they think they've seen this happen before in another country when they were looking for Mr. Seleznev. Once there was something put out over the Interpol red notice was put out, it seems he got away. So it's undisputed that now the Russians know, because the red notice is issued, Mr. Seleznev is coming around 10 o'clock to take an 11 o'clock flight, and we have to act fast. No warrant ever comes. No warrant is ever issued. No Maldivian ever arrests him. The United States eventually concedes he was arrested by a Secret Service agent, Mr. Schwander. And if you look at the red notice, which is excerpts of record, I think it's 188, around 122. It has two little provisions. One is about extradition, but there is no extradition treaty between the Maldives and the United States, and the other is labeled provisional arrest. And it says, for the country at the request of which the present notice has been published, that's the United States of America, this red notice is to be treated as a formal request for provisional arrest. This red notice issued at the request of the United States is the United States' request that the Maldivians go and arrest him, which, it's undisputed, never happened. So the district court's finding that the red notice was apparently accepted as an alternative to Maldivian arrest makes no sense, because the red notice says, we want you to go arrest him, which everybody agrees never happened.
So what does that lead you to conclude? I understand what you just went through, but why does that rise to a due process violation?
Well, I think it you, I think it's Struckman that says, does this violate a right, a recognized right of Mr. Seleznev, or jus cogens? Does it taint the judicial process? Is there a need to deter this kind of behavior? And if so, I think it could be either outrageous governmental misconduct, or it can give rise to the need for the exercise of your supervisory powers to keep the hands of the court clean and to deter this kind of conduct. And it does violate his recognized rights. I think his lawyers pointed out in the reply brief, it violates the International Covenant of Civil and Political Rights, Article 13, clearly. There's no argument as to why it doesn't. It violates jus cogens. It taints the judicial process. It's a warrant issued out of this court. And that's what he's arrested on. So I would ask you to just think of it as the shoe on the other foot. Think of it if the Russians did this in the Maldives by spiriting away an American citizen that they wanted to try for something in Russia, and the finding was, well, a red notice arrived, and so suddenly we don't need an arrest warrant anymore, and we can just take him. This country would call that kidnapping, and I think you should too. Thank you. I don't have much time left, but what I have, I'll keep.
Yeah, thanks, Mr. Lopez. Now, your time's almost up, but We'll add an extra minute to that for rebuttal for your planning purpose. And we'll let the government have an extra minute.
Thank you, Your Honor.
If it wants it.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the court. Michael Morgan for the United States. I appreciate the dilemma counsel finds himself in.
Put the extra minute on the government's time.
Parachuting into this case late. But oral argument is not the time to be advancing claims that are nowhere in the briefs. Nowhere in the briefs is there any claim that the motion to dismiss should be reversed due to an erroneous factual finding. Nowhere. Similarly, nowhere in the briefs is there a claim that the district court committed procedural error in failing to adequately explain its sentence. Nowhere. Those claims are waived. Full stop. On the merits, what counsel would like this court to call a kidnapping was in fact a paradigm example of cooperation between two countries to bring a fugitive to justice. The Maldivian officials agreed to assist. The Maldivian officials, on their own, with the approval of their attorney general and president, expelled him into the United States custody, and he was immediately taken to the United States for a prompt arraignment. Under no set of facts could that rise to a level of a due process violation, not under this court's precedents, and certainly not under the Supreme Court's precedents. So, and with respect to whether or not there was a violation of Maldivian law, that's simply irrelevant. Whether or not a domestic arrest warrant was required under domestic law, which, considering the Attorney General of the Maldives signed off on this operation, I would doubt. But even assuming that to be the case, that's not misconduct that's chargeable to the United States. The United States specifically requested that Mr. Seleznev be expelled in accordance with Maldivian law. Whatever the Maldivians did, whatever remedy Mr. Seleznev may have against the Maldivians, that is not a basis for this court for the district court to divest itself over jurisdiction when the United States officials violated none of his rights.
Mr. Morgan, so I have a question for you. It was represented by the appellant that the guidelines range went up to life. Could have been life. What I wanted to know was what went into the guidelines determination. Did it have to do with the number of counts, the amount of money involved, or?
If we're talking about the actual cap of the guidelines, because he was capped out at 43, even with a level one, the guidelines did provide for a life sentence, but none of the counts of conviction, in fact, would authorize a life sentence. So under the guidelines, the guideline sentence is the maximum permissible statutory sentence, which in this case, if I've done my math correctly, is 515 years. If you take every count and run it consecutive, that's the maximum sentence that would be allowed. This was a 27-year sentence. I'm not going to stand before this court and say that's not a severe sentence, but it's also a sentence that shows that the district court was not really influenced by the guideline calculation. I mean, it knew what the range was, but it was not trying to max him out in that respect.
It'd be kind of hard to sentence him to 500 years unless he was a sequoia tree or something.
He would need excellent health care to survive, that's true. But it does go to show that, I mean, even a 27-year sentence is not, I understand the position that given certain health conditions Mr. Seleznev has, that this is functionally a life sentence. I'm not certain that's true. There's been no showing that the Bureau of Prisons can't adequately care for Mr. Seleznev in his custody. With respect to one point that counsel made, that somehow his medical conditions support a lesser sentence because he's not going to commit crime, what did he do after he was suffered those injuries in his terrorist attack? After he recovered, he started up again. So obviously whatever issues arose from those injuries, they certainly didn't prevent him from acting in the same criminal manner he had before. So I don't really understand how the fact that he has these injuries is somehow a mitigating factor. And I would also point out that the record makes quite clear that the district court knew very well Mr. Seleznev's medical conditions. He actually discussed it, as Judge Pai has pointed out, and it's on ER 58. He says, quote, "Your third chance to avoid all this occurred when you had a near-death experience that should have been your wake-up call to abandon the fraud that you had already committed in multiple ways. 3 months of recovery, struggling for your life. That should have been an invitation to give your wrongs, to right your wrongs, and recognize that you had to be given a second chance in life. Instead, your recovery was focused on recalibrating and building a cyber fraud dynasty." The court knew all about this. It just didn't feel that that Mr. Seleznev's medical conditions warranted a further downward variance. Neither this court's precedents nor the Supreme Court precedents require a court to address in detail every mitigation argument advanced by a defendant. As long as the record shows that the court knew about the arguments and considered them, that is sufficient. That is procedurally sufficient. And the record here is, under this court's precedents, is more than sufficient for you to find that he considered them and committed no procedural error in considering them.
What was the, I can't remember now, too many cases, but what was the government's
30 years.
Sentencing recommended? Yes, 30 years.
30 years.
It was the probation officer recommended 27.
Correct.
And the judge?
Went with probation.
Went with probation.
Yes. The defense didn't offer a recommendation. They just asked for a substantial downward variance, mm-hmm. which they got. Mm-hmm. And again, when you're looking.
Were you the trial lawyer?
I was not.
What was in the calculation to recommend a 30-year sentence? You know?
Well,
I mean, I'm going to tell you, it's 27 years does, as you started out saying, seems like a severe sentence.
Well, I think there's a lot of benchmarks you can look at. In our sentencing brief, we pointed out some, you know, fraud defendants in our district with much lesser losses who got 30-year sentences. We pointed out perhaps like one of the best benchmarks is Mr. Seleznev was indicted in the District of Nevada on charges that arose out of the very scheme that's at issue here. Mm-hmm. And a low-level player in that case went to trial and got 20 years. A low-level player. All he did was buy some cards on Mr. Seleznev's website and commit street-level fraud. 20 years. Mr. Seleznev's the kingpin. Mm-hmm. He's the kingpin. How is a 15-year sentence for the kingpin not disproportionate? And this court affirmed that 20-year sentence subject to a substantive reasonableness challenge. So if 20 years is substantively reasonable for a low-level player, an extra 7 for the top dog can't be substantively unreasonable. And I think that's sort of where the government's calculus was, is looking at those players.
Thank you. That helps.
So what would you say are the most important Supreme Court precedents and Ninth Circuit precedents that give us guidance about how to decide what's substantively reasonable?
Well, it's simply whether, I mean, that's unfortunate because the precedents are simply that the district court has discretion and it's an abuse of discretion standard. And
don't have any cases. We have not intervened.
No, I mean, that's
generally in sentencing decisions.
No, because it really, sentencing is for the district court. It's got to be, I mean, I understand the court ultimately in Rassam reversed for substantive reasonableness because the sentence was too low. You don't see the court intervening, and that was a very unique case. But in the Mine Run case, this court does not interfere unless the district court is completely off the reservation. And you just can't say that on this record. And I think it's unfair to Judge Jones to suggest that he didn't explain his sentence. His explanation went on for over 8 pages. I mean, he went in detail about all the aggravating factors he found and how Mr. Seleznev had never accepted responsibility, how he had tried to manipulate the courts after his arrest, how he had just on and on and on about all the aggravating factors he found. And when we're thinking about this sentence, I think it's important to remember Mr. Seleznev was operating on the thinking that he was immune from sanction. That was his MO. He stayed in Russia knowing full well that he could operate and face no consequences. He thought that when he went to the Maldives. He just miscalculated. But that's a defendant, again, who I have, if you're thinking about if he's likely to be a recidivist, why is he not, when he's finished with his sentence, going to be removed to Russia? There's no reason he wouldn't start up again. He would again be immune. So in terms of general deterrence, I think the court was quite correct to say that these cyber hackers who are overseas and immune from process need to know that they are not operating with impunity. And if they step out, they face substantial risk. I mean, look at the losses in this case. Almost 170...
To some extent, this just ensures that hackers in Russia will never leave... won't visit Maldives again.
It may hurt the Maldivian tourist industry, I understand. You know? But it's true. It's that they really do think that there's nothing to deter them. And,
correct.
And I think the district court needed to send that message as a matter of general deterrence, that these crimes, if you are caught, you will pay a price. And again, when you look at the amount of losses, almost 170 million, that is a lot of money. Mr. Seleznev caused a lot of damage to small businesses. We're not, you know, those are the real victims here. The financial institutions, no one is going to shed a tear for the financial institutions. But the mom-and-pop businesses who are like having to pay these remediation costs, record shows one of them actually went bankrupt. I mean, this is serious harm, and it calls out for serious punishment. And certainly under an abuse of discretion standard, you can't say that Judge Jones abused his discretion, especially comparatively.
Does the record indicate the number of victims in the case, both mom and pop stores and big banks?
The record, there is a complete list of restitution that's owed. The trial record, we highlighted the local businesses that were harmed, and there was, in fact, that one of the businesses did testify that he was bankrupted by the remediation cost that resulted from this. So the record does support that actual finding. And again, when you compare this sentence, though stiff, to the sentences to other fraudsters, again, that are identified in the government sentencing brief, 20 years, 25 years, for losses less than this, so for 170 million, 27 years is not substantively unreasonable.
So there was one issue the counsel didn't address. I'd just like to hear the government's views on it, and that's the proffer issue.
Yes.
With respect to whether or not he waived. Waived the 410, I guess, privilege.
Yes. The issue, as I understand it, the district court found that he waived the 410 with respect to his own statements. The district court found that he had not been adequately advised with respect to how his proffer would affect his attorney's ability to present a defense. So the court ruled that the 410 waiver was still applicable, or it was not applicable to defense counsel's arguments. So no matter what defense counsel did, Mr. Seleznev's proffer statements were not coming in. The court did go further and said, counsel, you have an ethical obligation not to present evidence or argument that you know or have reason to believe is false. If you think you have a good faith basis to believe that some proffer statement might not be true, and so therefore you want to present this, that's fine. But that was separate and apart from the waiver. So
that's just a general ethical obligation.
It's a general ethical obligation.
Right.
And the court vindicated Mr. Seleznev's 410 rights by not enforcing that one provision of the waiver that he didn't agree to. So he's been given all the relief he was due. Does that address what the court's concern was about that point?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to make sure I understood it.
Yeah, it's limited. It's just limited to what defense counsel could. Mm-hmm. But
did they ever suggest that there was something they wanted to present?
No.
That they couldn't?
No, and in fact, at the evidentiary hearing, then defense counsel sort of recognized that the reason they wanted the proffer, and in fact, it was Mr. Seleznev and his father who were pushing for the proffer, because they all recognized the evidence of guilt, especially once his computer was searched. It was just, there was no defense. The normal defense in a hacker case is I'm not the person behind the keyboard, and that is the defense they raised. Mm. You know, they argued that there was evidence from which you could suggest that someone else was doing it, that the government hadn't proven, which they were, and that's the thing, they were allowed to argue the government hadn't met his burden, and they did. They argued that the government hadn't proven that Mr. Seleznev was behind the keyboard. But there was really no way, once you had his computer, once you had all the passwords to all the carding sites, that they would be able to get up and say with a straight face, my client didn't do it, which is really the only defense that was barred by, that would have been barred by the proffer waiver or the court's ultimate ruling enforcing the counsel's ethical obligations. So no, the defense has never identified any defense that they somehow were unable to present because of this ruling. Unless the court has questions with respect to any of the other issues, the government would ask that the judgment and sentence be affirmed. Thank you.
Fine, thank you.
I wanted to respond to the contention that things weren't raised. With respect to the finding of fact that I say has no support, I agree. That was not raised by anybody until me today. But all that stuff is in the record, including the red notes, and it's there, and it makes it plain that it's clear error. With respect to the argument that they did not raise failure to explain argument, I don't agree with that, and I refer you to page 61 of the opening brief, where Mr. Seleznev's lawyers wrote, the court completely failed to mention, let alone consider, appellant's precarious medical condition. Okay, they didn't use the word explain, but they said he didn't even get to considering, he didn't even mention it. And he mentioned it, he didn't talk. So I think that was raised. With respect to, you asked a question, Judge Paez, about did the defense offer a specific sentencing recommendation? They did not. However, at the very end of their presentation, defense counsel said, Mr. Seleznev has already been locked up for 3 years now prior to sentencing, and he's already suffered a lot. He won't do it again. And Judge Jones responded directly to that, and he seemed to interpret it as suggesting I give him just 3 years. That would plainly not be enough, and it would reward people that they only have to go do 3 years of time in order to make these massive amounts of money. He didn't exactly suggest 3 years, but he kind of quietly hinted at it, which I would say would not be a reasonable sentence, really, for this. When you ask about the size of the loss and the guidelines, I do want to point out that the special application note for fraud cases says that any time there's an unauthorized use of a credit card, it automatically, the court shall treat that as a $500 minimum loss. And that means, in this case, with 2-point-something million stolen credit cards, that when they multiplied that by $500, they came up with a loss of $1.2 billion, which automatically added 30 levels. Just 30 levels, bingo, which is, I think, one of the reasons probation said that these guidelines really don't make a lot of sense here. I thought the opening brief did a good job, and I repeat, of saying there's an awful lot of overlap here between sophistication, use of a computer, more than 10 victims, large loss. Yes, when you're involved with a computer hacking and stealing these kind of stolen numbers off credit cards, all of those things are going to always be present. And yet they contributed another 2 levels and another 2 levels and another 2 levels and another 2 levels.
Mr. Lobsons.
I'm done.
I'm afraid you're over your time. It's an interesting case. It's excellent argument from you and
thank you, Your
Honor. Mr. Morgan. But if I give you more time, we'd have to let Mr. Morgan have some more time.
Thank you.
Thank you both for excellent arguments. We're always happy when we sit in Seattle because it has such great advocates here. So thank you both. And the Seleznev case shall be submitted. And as I mentioned at the outset, Judge Pragerson will watch and listen to the arguments and participate in the panel decision, which you'll get from us in due course. Thank you again. We are adjourned.